أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم سنريهم آياتنا في الآفاق وفي أنفسهم حتى يتبين لهم أنه الحق أولم يكفي بربك أنه على كل شيء شهيد
people watching one day international than the number of people watching 5-day matches. Why? Because one day is more aggressive and there are more people watching 2020 than 50 overs match. Why? Because it is faster and aggressive. He has not won the match. That you were praying for Elman and I got grams. They are like duk 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 duk, they say. So if you give him pure water, he will not be happy. If you give him Pepsi, he will be happy. They are interested in the beautiful lady who comes and allures. Buy Pepsi, 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 and the child wants Pepsi. They will be experts in maths and science and other things, but they will not be experts in human relations. So he is a stranger in his own house. So he is a stranger in his own house. So he is a stranger in his own house.
Alhamdulillah. Wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah. Wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajmain amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wa hlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Respected chairman, my brothers, my sisters, my elders, Jazakallahu khairan for being here, and we are gathered here no matter the number of audience, but the concern is a very prime one. And unfortunately, a majority of the parents and a majority of people in the society, they don't consider this as a problem, as the subject is who spoils the children. And the reason is that many people don't realize that the children, or we can say the generation as a whole, is getting spoiled. So today we shall think as to what are the factors that are responsible for the spoiling of the children. Because tomorrow the whole generation will grow up. And imagine a grown up generation and a spoiled one, bad habits, bad friends, crime, violence, aggression. You see, to name any quality which concerns about a person's personality, which mars, which destroys or disfigures a man's personality, and you will find it that it is being planted in the minds of children, whether it is a boy or a girl. Children are becoming aggressive. Children are becoming violent. Children are the one who decides which brand of things their parents should buy. Children know more about which is the latest mobile. Children are becoming extravagant. Children are the biggest customers of branded items. Children are the largest number of audience of television programs. According to a report, 90% of children, they see only 10% of the programs made for children on television, and the rest of the 90% they see programs made for grown-ups. Then children are becoming foul-mouthed people. They use abusive languages. So these are some of the observations that we are noticing, or people must be observing things that are happening to our children. So what are the causes and what is the way out? The biggest cause, as the chairman rightly mentioned a few questions that I posed in the advertisement, that we are only concerned about the children's career. If you ask a father or a mother, what is the biggest concern about your child? They will say, I want my child to pass in SSC with flying colors, good grades, he should become a doctor or an IT engineer. These are the expectations of parents. Then when the child grows up a bit more and he goes into the college as a young man, and we pose the question again to the parents, now what's your biggest concern? Again they will say, he should get married, we must have a house for him, we must give him a separate house, he should get a good wife. But nobody ever says, or there are very few people who say, that the biggest concern about my children, for me, is I worry that they should get spoiled. They may get spoiled. This is my biggest concern. And only when you put on a priority something as your concern, then you keep a watchful eye on that substance or an issue. So the parents are to be blamed for the spoiling of children. And I'll present before you some of my arguments later on in the question and answer. If you don't agree, we have a mic, you can pose questions and you can put your opinions also. Why parents are responsible? As I said in the beginning, that they are not concerned that the children are spoiling. And why is it happening? Because everybody is getting spoiled. So nobody considers it to be an evil thing. For example, if you go to a swimming pool where everybody is in their underwear and undergarments, bikinis and undergarments, we see everybody over there. So nobody objects each other that why are you wearing a bikini? But if the same type of dress is worn in a market, people will object as to what is this? This is obscene. Why does it happen? Because here there are only few people who are doing that, and the rest of the people, they find it wrong. There everybody is doing, so nobody is finding wrong. You understood? In the same way, every child wants to have a mobile. Every child wants to have a cigarette. Every child is aggressive, he's doing bodybuilding. Every child must have a girlfriend or a boyfriend. Everybody wants to have it. So nobody realizes that it is bad. Inside the heart, the human instinct, it may tell us, but it is subjugated by the things that are happening around us. And why are parents not concerned? I'll give you more reasons for that. Because this is the life which is a very fast life nowadays. Imagine a father coming home in the evening, tired, exhausted. And he has a briefcase from his office which carries papers. And in his head, he has the problems which he's carrying, the office problems in his head. At his office, he was scolded by his boss, or he had a fight with some customers. So he's tensed. The business was not proper. So when he's at home, he does not give time to his child. And the mother is worried that the father is at home and is very angry. So she will ask the children to go inside or go down and play. So the parents, especially the father, they are unable to communicate with their children as the communication should be. Now these fathers, when they are at home on Sundays or Fridays or Saturday evenings or on a holiday, what do? They are busy on internet chat or watching their favorite program on television, or nowadays there are more cricket matches. So they are busy with their own interest, own leisure. Or they may go out with their friends, or they may talk to somebody on a mobile, or they may do some office work. They are very busy. And this is a general epidemic among the fathers throughout the globe. Whether it is in Tokyo, Singapore, America, England, India, Bangalore, Mumbai, this is a very common problem about fathers. So now, in Singapore, there is a new trend that has come out. Workshops conducted for fathers. So they try to make the fathers affectionate. And there's a complete cover article on the Times magazine about the fathers' workshops. So now fathers are trained how to become a good father. In certain companies like IBM and others, there are special leave for father. If you have a son, if you want to take 2 months leave, or you work at home, as long as you give good results, you can work at home and stay with your family. Why? Because the companies are realizing that if a person is not peace in his mind, if he is not at peace with himself or at home, he is not going to give a good production in the office. So ultimately it affects the whole of economy. So these fathers, they are busy at home, they are not able to communicate. Finally, what happens that they are a stranger in their own homes. If he's a man who comes, who goes in the morning when the children are sleeping, and when the children are sleeping, he comes home late and then he goes to sleep. So he is like a stranger at home. On Sunday, he is like a furniture at home. Like you have a chair, a sofa, a father sitting on the sofa, reading in the morning the Times of India, and then Hindustan Times, and then magazines, and then goes to internet and replies and chats and talks, and then calls up his friends, and in the evening he goes out to swimming pools and clubs, and he's a busy man. He's unavailable to his children, so he is a stranger in his own house. If you people, my brothers over here, those who are fathers, if you are into this, be aware. Don't be a stranger to your own children. It is very dangerous. Now what happens? Because of this thing, there is a communication gap. And people call it a generation gap. So say, oh, it is, you know, because there is a generation gap between the father and the son, and the father and the daughter. It happens. So I say, no, it is a communication gap. Because you did not teach your child, somebody else is teaching your child. You did not groom your child the way you wanted your child to be, so somebody else is grooming his child the way he wants it to be. And who are this somebody? We will see later on. So parents are responsible. Second argument of mine, why parents are responsible? You must be very familiar with domestic violence. So the father and the mother, they quarrel at home, they use abusive languages. And the child, he's a young child. He takes whatever he sees around him. His mind, his subconscious mind absorbs. And it reflects in his own personality. Because of parents. So what should have been done in the bedroom? That has been done in the drawing room. Parents are fighting in a very hostile manner. Abusive languages. Some even end up in a quarrel, or people may end up breaking up the marriages. So these children, they grow up that way. So parents are major, they hold a major responsibility. Why? Again, we go for more arguments. Why parents are still responsible? As I said, that there is a communication gap. So what happens? That the child is also unaware of his own relatives, chacha, mamu, maternal uncle, paternal uncle. He is not aware of them. He don't know who they are. They come like guests and they go away. So this gap goes on increasing. And then finally, the child has to look elsewhere for a company. And these parents, they don't realize. They think, or many of the parents, they think that just by putting our children in a good school, my child will grow up as a good citizen, which is wrong. A good school means good teacher in maths, in science, in history, geography, language. That is the duty of the teacher. But parenting cannot be expected from teacher. If she does it, it is a bonus mark. Otherwise, it is the duty of the father and the mother to look after the child. So parents are responsible. By putting a child in a good school is not enough. If a child gets 80%, 90%, A grade, first grade, even then it is not enough that this child is becoming a good citizen. Why does that happen? Because we are into a rat race. You know rat race? Where everybody is running in one direction and nobody is realizing somebody falls down, somebody falters. Everybody wants to reach the winning post. Rat race. Where everybody wants their child to become successful in his academy and in his career. Means finance. He should earn more. How is your son? He is very good. Why? Because he earns 50,000 rupees a month now. But the poor mother, she doesn't know that the boy is getting rude towards his parent. She doesn't realize this, that my son is giving me back replies, my son is into wrong friends, or wrong habits, smoking, affairs, all these things. She doesn't realize that. Because my son earns 50,000 rupees, he's a good son. He's a successful personality, which is a wrong criteria or a wrong measurement to measure somebody's success. But everybody is doing. So we are all running in the same direction. That is what we call a rat race. And in this rat race, the child becomes a doctor or engineer, but he loses his morals. He becomes a doctor or engineer, but he smokes. He's into wrong friends. Why? Because at the root level, somebody did not put water on this plant properly. Like, you know, there is a very good story that there was a Maulana who was invited by a person who owned a large farm. And he said, Maulana, pray that this time we should get good almonds. You know, if you pray nicely, you are a Maulana. You pray that this time my farm should give, it should reap a good harvest of almonds. And the Maulana used to go and pray, Allah, please give him a barakah, his almond. And it went on for months. One day the boss called him and said, Maulana, what type of a prayer did you put? He said, why? He said, you were praying for almond and I got grams chana. So the Maulana was confused. He said, how could that be possible? I was praying for almonds and you got chanas, grams. Then he asked, sir, what did you sow? He said, chanas. So, my dear gentleman, if you sow sana chanas and then you expect almonds, how can you get it even by praying? In the same way, if we don't cultivate good habits in a child, only focus on history, geography, math, science, computers, IT. If we focus only on these things, how can we get a healthy generation? They will be experts in maths and science and other things, but they will not be experts in human relations. So, we go towards the second main cause. After knowing that the parents were the prime cause, now because the parents are not attentive, there are other factors which are paying attention towards our children. Who are these strangers? So we go to the television. They are the best friend of your child. And what the child sees, he absorbs, as I said. So these children, they have found a good parent in television. You say friend, you say teacher. And you know how many hours the television teaches your child? How many hours? If your child is in the best school, on an average, There are 180 working days in a year. 180 working days and 5 hours a day, the schoolings on an average. So that takes us up to 900 hours a year. 900 hours a year in school. And in 10 years, from 1st standard to 10th standard, you have 9,000 hours in school, learning math, science, all those things. 9,000 hours. In 9,000 hours, the child grooms up to become a potential doctor or an engineer. Agreed? That is the thing that happens. But if we see that the child watches on an average only 3 hours television, which is very, I am taking the least. Some people say Indian children, they watch 4.5 hours, because nowadays there are a lot of presentations of sports and lot of channels. But I take it minimum 3 hours, 3 to 4 hours. 365 multiplied by 4, it is little more than schooling. And if you multiply by 10 years, hundreds of hours more than schooling, hundreds of hours. So what happens? The child has two simultaneous learnings, history, geography, math. The teacher is a big bore, you know, she always keeps on scolding and we have to complete notes. So they are not interested in that. They are interested in the beautiful lady who comes and allures, buy Pepsi, 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 and the child wants Pepsi. He wants Pepsi. Who told? A beautiful man, a good looking guy, say Shah Rukh Khan, he comes and drinks Pepsi and there are two beautiful girls around him. So the children want Pepsi. So if you offer them Bisleri water, clean, boiled water, they will say, what is this? If you know, if you tell them that Pepsi is very harmful, everybody knows, but still Pepsi is being sold. On an average, the Indians gulp down 7,000 crore worth colas, Pepsi colas and Coca colas, 7,000 crores rupees we gulp down of things which has pesticide inside it, because everybody likes it now. So children, they like it. So a beautiful model comes and tells them, buy Pepsi, drink Pepsi, so he wants Pepsi. So if you give him pure water, he will not be happy. If you give him Pepsi, he will be happy. Because you did not get a chance to tell what are the good things in good water and clean water. And that beautiful model came and convinced your child what was wrong for him, what was dangerous for him. And he accepted it. Poor child, he accepted it. Then what happens? The same types of couples, they come. On an average, you know what is this television? Normally people say, the television is nothing but a crowd collecting source or a device to collect crowd. Like you have, you know, with the madaris, duk 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 duk, they say, and they have a monkey and they keep on playing duk 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 till they gather a huge crowd, and then the monkey starts playing tricks. So these programs on the televisions, they are like duk 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 duk. So people come and assemble before the television screen. They know that, oh, today at 7:30 we are going to have highlight of the World Cup cricket final, and they keep on announcing whole day, tonight duk 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 duk, like how you know that madari, he announces, come on, see monkey tricks, monkey tricks, monkey tricks. So they say, come on, come on, in the evening 8:30 p.m. you are told, you are bombarded 100 times a day. So the whole of the nation, crores of people, they sit before the television, and for first 10 minutes they only show you advertisements. That is the monkey tricks. Buy this, buy that. And when children see, they want to have it, because it is presented in a very nice manner. So now there are two teachers, one at home, the father who is always scolding, and the mother who is always shouting, don't do this, don't do that. On the other hand, there are nicely dressed people speaking very professionally with your child and telling, do this, do this. Even if it is wrong, the whole world knows that it is wrong, yet they want it. For 9,000 hours of their school life, they are having two parallel school, one in the classroom, another in front of the television. How many advertisements a child watches? Don't listen to me. Tomorrow you count it. See how many advertisements. If there is a 50-50 match, 100 overs. After every over, there are three advertisements. So you have 300 models or 300 people coming 300 times and telling you, do this. But naturally, the subtle mind, the soft mind of a child, which is like a clay in water, it can be molded anyway and it gets molded. So when the child grows up, you will not like he's wearing an earring in his ear or his pants are below. It goes almost, he has not worn the pants. That's how obscenely boys and girls have started wearing trousers. Who told them? The beautiful model who comes on the television, she comes and tells them, this is good, so they want to imitate. And those who were supposed to tell them, either they don't have any time to tell them, or they tell it in a very arrogant manner, they scold, they shout, they yell at the children, thinking it as a birthright, so there is a communication gap. And somebody is communicating some other message to your children. And what do the children learn from television? Let's take a stock of it. There was a psychologist in America on a website. She has posted an experiment saying that if you want to see how children are addicted to television, she says that television is also an addiction. If you want to see how children are addicted to television, what do? You start a television program, for example, a football match or a cricket match. I'm giving you my example. In which final overs are going on, slog overs, and only 2 overs to go, 2 wickets, 5 runs, and it's a nail-biting finish, and everybody wants to see what's going to happen. You get up and switch off the TV and notice the reaction of the audience over there at that time. Same reaction. If a drug addict does not get his drug, how will he react? Very similar reactions. That's what the psychologists say. Hey, give me, start the TV. You idiot, you get out, what have you done? You see the remarks that they pass. Even if the person who switched off the television is the father of the family, head of the family, yet people cannot tolerate. Why? Let us see. Normally the programs on the television that you all see, these programs are of two types. One, aggressive programs. And the other, soft programs, which are flops. So nobody watches soft programs. Would anybody see a table tennis match or a golf match on television? Nobody. Nobody sees, right? Because there is no aggression in it. But people see football, people see cricket, because there is a lot of aggression in that. And moreover, there are more people watching one day international than the number of people watching 5 day matches. Why? Because one day is more aggressive. And there are more people watching 20-20 than 50 overs match. Why? Because it is faster and aggressive. It's a junoon. It shows a junoon of what will happen. Come on. Everybody is in aggressive mode. Everybody. And more people watch the highlight than 20-20 match because it is the most aggressive. They choose the best shots, even a football. Somebody's falling, somebody's kicking, somebody's abusing. You see how many times they show Harbhajan Singh fighting with that Australian player. They show it again and again and again because people like it. It's aggressive. It, you know, makes your blood boil. So you become like that. And a child watches 5,000 aggressive shots in 1 year. 5,000 aggressive shots in 1 year on television. It includes violence also. Hitting, killing, murders, pulling out the gun and shooting. So these things he sees for 5,000 times a year. In 10 years, he sees 50,000 times. And no wonder he carries a gun in his pocket to school and he pulls out and shoots his classmates and teachers. Don't be amazed. It was not the fault of the teacher. It was somebody else who was teaching. Because the teacher, poor teacher, she was only teaching maths and science. Nobody taught him morals. Nobody taught him that this is bad, this is injurious. Nobody. Everybody is watching. Somebody, they take these lessons more seriously and they carry gun and they become criminals. And these are becoming a routine style or routine in our lives, whether it is India or America. Now these news don't appear in front pages. It will go into the corners. Now because it is accepted, there is no sensation in that. There is no sensation in that now. Because everybody is laughing. So aggression is what the children, they take from them. Then what else do they take? Extravagance. We want to buy this, we want to buy that. Papa, you know, a boy in my class, he has a new Hero Honda model. And you are not buying me a bicycle also. What kind of a father? So poor father, he is under tension. What am I doing for my child? He is worried. And the mother fights with the father. You don't do anything. Look at the neighbor's children. They have a mobile. They have motorcycles. And what you are running? 20,000, 25,000 man. What is this? I am not happy with you. And this thing goes on. So the poor father, he goes and takes some money on installment, on loan. And he buys a motorcycle. Because his son should be like that. So there is extravagance. There was a time when our evenings were passed in gardens, or we used to visit relatives, right or wrong, we used to go and visit our relatives, or go to a wedding party and meet our relatives, or we used to go to garden and sit in Bombay, we used to go to Chowpatty and Marine Beach is in Chennai. But now, if you are bored, you go to the malls. So people go to the malls. It has become parks, modern parks. So you go to the malls, and then when you go for tafri, like, you know, let's go and see what's there. But the child wants this, he does a window shopping. I want that, I want this, I want this, I want this. And they want this, that, they want this, that, and everything they wanted. So what happens? He becomes extravagant. Then he must have money. So we have more and more children getting addicted to crime. You know, stealing and robbing. And you know, according to a survey, which was printed in the Times of India, a major number of robbery of mobile phone is done by youth under 20. Why? Why don't people of our age steal? Because we know that our lives can run without mobiles. But the child wants it, so he steals. He goes to a shop, nobody's looking, and he picks up and puts it in his pocket and walks out. It's a small device. It can be carried because of the things that he has learned, extravagance, crime. Because he could not control his extravagance, he went to criminal ways. This is a dangerous thing, another. You understood? So, media makes our children aggressive. Because advertisement happens. They come and tell on television many times, buy this, so there is a new style, everybody must be having this style. Then media also makes our children obscene and, you know, foul-mouthed. The children, you will notice, the languages have changed. There was a time we say, hello, how are you? Kaise hain aap? Achhe hain. Today the style has changed. Kya hai? Kaisa hai? Kya karega? This is the way. There was a guy in my society in Bombay. I told him that, you see, there is a non-Muslim. Can you go and talk to him nicely about Islam? He said, why not? See, the poor fellow does not know that his language is crude. He does not know. He thinks that everything is okay. So he says, hey, kya karta hai? Tu shirk karega, tu jahannam mein jayega. You see, abe kya karta hai? Mar jayega aise hi. See, this is, where did he get this style from? He is not imitating the scholars. He is not imitating the good people. He is imitating that Salman Khan, Sanjay Dutt, you know, Munna Bhai. So he does dawa and good things in the same manner. He is imitating them. So he is learning from somewhere. So his language is becoming crude. They are becoming, children are becoming rude. It's very common. You can observe them. Then they become stylish, you know. People smoke cigarettes in school and colleges. I'll come. I will go there now. First, let me talk about media. Then I'll talk about peer pressure. So when he borrows these languages from heroes, the heroes have changed now. Those who were seeing movies 20, 25 years ago, the heroes at that time were gentlemen, you know, they were nicely guy with a short hair like Dharmendra and all. Though film is already haram, we all know that. But I'm just giving an example because many people watch or used to watch it. So the Dharmendra and Manoj Kumar with a small hair and nicely dressed, and the villain, you know, gunda-like person, like a nukkar. He's like that. But now the heroes have changed. The heroes are like that now. So they are nukkar type gundas, gunda style, you know, having a cigarette, alay, kya karta hai, whatever. So the boys, you know, they're a hero, he's paid a crore of rupees for doing that. So they want to have that. They have heroes, you know, in cricketers, like Dhoni's hairstyle, you know, long hair he had. He had long hair. So there was a guy in my locality, he had a long hair. I said, why? He said, no, Dhoni looks, you become a superstar. So I said, do you play cricket like him? No. Then by growing hair, you cannot become like Dhoni. You see, it is just like watching a cricket match and becoming a cricketer. While listening to a commentary, you don't become a cricketer. You have to go to the nets and practice it. So this is because people have started absorbing wrong heroes. So when they absorb wrong heroes, there is something wrong in the society. The whole of the generation becomes like that, so nobody realizes it. Unless somebody comes and tells you. After spending 20-25,000 rupees, we collect people and we tell them that this is wrong, so now you start thinking. So media is very dangerous. It makes your child aggressive. Even computer games, yes, even computer games. You would wonder what's wrong in computer games? I say it's very dangerous, more dangerous than television. Computer games are more dangerous than television games. You know why? On a television, the hero comes and shoots. Somebody else is shooting. But on computer, you have the trigger in your hand and you are shooting. On a television, a hero drives a car and goes into racing and all that. But on the computer, you are having the steering and accelerator and you run and you bang. So next time when you see motorcycles whizzing past by you, know that that person is playing computers and he has learned motorcycle, not in school or on the roads, but on computers, computer games. So he has learned how to ride a motorcycle on computers with 100 and 120 speed. So he runs like that. And a majority of the accidents in Bombay, the whole bridge of JJ had to be closed for motorcycle drivers because people are driving very rough. And a majority of them are under 20. And majority of them, unfortunately, they are Muslims. So this is the condition of people. So they have to close down the whole of bridge, of which is the longest bridge, 2.6 kilometers. No motorcycle will pass from here because they go and they bang. The road is empty. They want to drive very fast. And a curve comes. So they try to imitate Hrithik Roshan, like Dhoom and I don't know the movie. Must be somebody knowing. So they try to imitate them. Wrong heroes from media. And it's bad, very bad. Now we go to the next factor. Who spoils the children? Peer, friend circle also spoils. Because the parents don't have time. The television is bad, so they go down and they play with friends. So this friend circle or peer pressure, it cultivates wrong habits and wrong choices in the minds of children. How? I'll give you an example. When I was in college, there were, you know, smoking was even at that time, but it was upcoming hobby. And guys who were rich, and I was in a big college, Bhavans College, where children of industrialists and film stars used to come. So everybody wanted to become their friends. You know, it's good not to be alone scene with Manoj Kumar's son and Dharmendra's son. You know, I used to stand with him, we eat samosas with him. So it was a status symbol. It was a status symbol at that time to be seen hanging around with these people, film stars and industrialists and rich man. But you know, there was something lacking in the style. Because these rich guys, they used to smoke imported cigarettes. Marlboro, Dunhill, these imported cigarettes, they used to smoke. And these guys, they never smoke. So they thought that, you know, we must smoke. So they start smoking. But they cannot afford cigarettes at that time, were 10 rupees, 20 rupees a box. Dunhill, Marlboro, they were 10 to 20 rupees a box at that time. So some of the children, some of the students, what they used to do, they used to look around for a box of Marlboro. And they used to pick it up, they clean it up and put Indian cigarettes and put it in their pocket. And the Marlboro was seen and people used to see and say, ah, he's smoking Marlboro. Who would see what is written on the cigarette? And they used to keep on smoking. So, you know, peer pressure always makes a person go wrong. That is why the Quran says, about Nuh alayhi salam, if you read his story in Surah Hud, that why did Nuh alayhi salam's son got deviated? Nuh alayhi salam tells his son, son, don't go with wrong friends. Don't be friend with the disbelievers and don't be friend with these people who are sinners. Come with me. So if your son chooses wrong friends, it is dangerous for him. He's playing with his akhirah. It's okay, the way of my speaking can make you laugh over here because I don't like people to sleep. So I, and this is my style of talking to my audience. But this is a very serious situation, that if your child falls into wrong friends, not only his life, but his akhirah is also dangerous. So peer pressure can lead children to other bad habits like extravagance. Why does the child want, as I said in the beginning part of my talk, because he sees his friends having imported shoes and Levi's jeans and jackets and caps, so he also must have it. In my time, when I was in college, there were some students who used to take private tuitions. They used to go for tuitions. Means they used to earn money by giving tuitions. And the money that they used to save was used to spend on their dresses and all that. They used to feel proud of it. Today's generation is not like that. They want fast money. Everything they want fast. Like kun fai kun. They have it and they should have it. They cannot wait. So peer pressure works upon them. There are girls from colleges of Beauty by Another's. There was a survey report came in the Times of India, in the DNA. It said that a majority of the girls who are into call girls business, prostitution business, white collar prostitution is called call girls. A majority of the girls, they come from middle class, but in order to stay in the race with their rich girlfriends, they go for prostitution, they earn money, and they buy expensive makeups, and they buy dresses and shoes and purses because they want to stay in the rat race. That is the reason why majority of the girls, they go into prostitution. Peer pressure. Like peer pressure. You don't have a girlfriend? Oh, yeah, you are a backward guy in college. This is in college. Few decades back, if somebody had an affair in the college, then he was looked down upon. What kind of a person is he? Don't talk to him. And we used to boycott him. Today, if a person does not have a girlfriend in college, people will boycott him. Nobody would like to talk to him. Your personality in the college is judged by the number of Valentine cards you get, by the number of roses you get on the rose day. Then you are a good personality in the college. Otherwise, you are a flop. Whether you get 90-95%, nobody bothered about it. You must have girlfriends. So to make into this peer pressure, girls and boys, they fall into affairs. They fall into affairs because of peer pressure. So friends have to be good. Then we have a neighborhood, another factor which spoils children. How does the neighborhood spoil children? Neighborhood, in a neighborhood, people are of every types. In a neighborhood. In class, at least you have a chance to go to the class teacher and talk about the children. What is this boy doing? What is that? The teacher also knows it. But in a neighborhood, people come, people go, and the child is playing. You don't know, you don't keep a watch. Like how we have results in schools. He failed. That means he is not attentive in his class. But downstairs when he is playing, you don't know. There are no grades for that. Nobody keeps an attendance card. With whom is he playing? Where is he going? What is he talking with his friends? Nobody knows. And the child gets spoiled. And when it is discovered by the parents, it is too late. Very late. Beyond your reach to get the child back. So neighborhood is also very important. And many affairs are taking place in a neighborhood. Because girls and the boys, you know, they see each other, they stay together. And it is, you know, if you talk to a neighbor, people don't object normally. So people don't realize that there is an affair. It is safer to keep it secret. So girls and boys fall into these things. How many things we counted? Parents, television, peer pressure, domestic violence, as well as, which was the last one? Neighborhood. These are the things that plays a major role in spoiling the children. So now, as an audience that we have gathered here, what should we do to stop it? We cannot build a wall around the children, right? We cannot build a wall. Don't talk to him, don't talk to him, don't see television, don't go to school. What will the child do? So what we have to do, we have to program the minds of our children to make them a wall themselves, that they, when they see something going wrong, they should be strong in resisting it and overcoming it. And there are many such children in today's society. whether he is a son of a Hindu or a Muslim or a Christian. There are good people. There are Orthodox Gujaratis. That's why the largest number of girls' colleges run, exclusively girls' colleges, are run by the Gujarati community. They are Orthodox. So Muslims, they feel safe to send their daughters to their school and colleges because it's an Orthodox. So there are good people. But we cannot make wall around our children. So what do? We cultivate a good thinking and a choosing style in their minds. We must teach them to distinguish between the right and the wrong, between the bad and the worse, between the worse and the worst. The child must know this is bad, this is worse, this is good, this is better, that is best. Besides the Islamic environment in our houses, besides that, there are other things that a father and a mother should do. Number one, communicate with your children. Talk to your children. Nobody can be more friendlier to a child than his parents, because they are having a love in their hearts which friends don't have. The friends are with you, with them, as long as they have money. Tomorrow, if you don't have money, the friends will go to somebody else. It is like that. But with parents, it is not like that. Even if the child is spoiled, the parents are parents. So before things go worse, the parents should start communicating with children. How? There are two ways of communicating. One is to talk to them. At least have one meal together, whether it is breakfast or lunch or dinner, at least one meal should be have together. And by having the meals, instead of talking about the cricketers and your favorite TV shows and all that, talk about what he did that day. Ask him, what are the best things that happened in your school today? What was the worst thing that happened in your school today? Let him open up. Let him speak out before you. So once he starts speaking and you don't get angry, don't lose your temper, he will start winning your confidence. And he will feel that if I do wrong sometimes, I can tell my parents because they will not be rude to me. Otherwise, what will happen? As I said, they will go to another teacher, that beautiful model who speaks very nice to your child. So the child likes that way. So we should adopt a very affectionate manner in our own personality. You don't have to work on your child. You have to work on yourself if you don't want your child to get spoiled. Remember, those who are making notes, please note down. If you want to prevent your child from being spoiled, you don't have to work upon them, you have to work upon yourselves. Self-control, tolerance, generosity. These are the things that a parent should cultivate in himself, because he is the best hero for his child at a tender age. He's the best hero. He sees his father speaking lies on telephones. So he learns speaking lie because it is safe. Every day, billions of fathers all around the globe, they break billions of promises to their children. Son, I'll come home soon today. Every father says that, and he comes late. And billions of fathers, they teach speaking lie to their children. Billions of children learn to speak lie from billions of fathers. So the fathers, especially the fathers, the poor mother is doing her job. The fathers should be more responsible towards the family life. They should give more time. As I said, two ways: communicating with your child regularly, at meals, in schools. You should know who are your child's best friend. If I ask any father, can you name 5 best friends of your son? They will have to think. They will have to think that who is my son's best friend? 5 best friends? Good friends are best friend? Can't say. So you must know who are your child's friends. Invite. There was a person who was, I was counseling him. And he said, you know, my son is getting spoiled. And his friend was smoking cigarette. He stays in the hostel. So his mother was supposed to visit. So this boy, he gave all his cigarettes to my son. And I think my son smokes. So what should I do? I said, see, you cannot correct only your son. You have to work upon that son also. somebody else's son also. Because your son, if you improve him, he will spoil. So why don't you invite him to your house one day and talk to him? That look, beta, you're smoking, this is bad for your health. Use all the arguments and logic, whatever you want to, you use it. But work upon somebody else's children also. Why? You cannot say that my son will be good and the rest of them will be bad. Ultimately, tomorrow, the dust is going to fall on you. If I wear clean clothes and I don't keep the room clean, that means if I sit on the chair or a sofa, my clothes are going to get dirty. So, it's a team effort. It's a social responsibility of Muslims. That's what the Quran says in Surah Imran chapter 3 verse 110. That kuntum khairam ummatin ukhrijat linnas. You are the best of the people brought out for the benefit of mankind. Benefit of mankind. See the emphasis over here. Mankind. So your son may be, your son's friend may be Hindu, Christian. You have to call him at home. You have to talk to him. You must know what a son does. You must know what are his hobbies. You must see the last page of your son's notebook. Rough book, things are written, scribbled over there. Then another method of improving your child or, you know, cultivating him to be a nice child or a grown-up son is that you must be a good example for him. What good things? Generosity. For example, on a holiday, instead of going to mall, you take your son to a cancer hospital or a municipality hospital's general ward where the poor people lie, people are suffering from cancer, people suffering from various disease, there are some old people, there are widows, there are young orphans, they are lying down, nobody to visit them. Take your child, buy some fruits, take some cash in your pocket and demonstrate to your child how generosity is done. No textbook can teach your child generosity the way you can do it, implementing it in a very practical manner. Take your child to the hospital and teach him. Show him generosity. A generous child, if your child is generous, he is heading towards a bright future. Imagine when the Quran was revealed, along with the Tawheed, before the Salah was farz, it was charity which Allah encouraged the Muslims to do. And we know that when we do charity, there are a lot of calamities that are going to fall upon us are being driven away by Allah Almighty. So if your child becomes generous, inshallah he will be protected by many calamities. So you are already doing the grassroots work by demonstrating to your child examples of generosity. Take your child, buy some fruits, go to your relative's house, your grandma, your chacha, mamu, let your child be there and talk to them. They are sick, they are old, go and meet them. The Quran says, in many places in Surah Baqarah also, that build your relations. Don't break the relations. Build them. So teach your child how to build relations with people. PRO work. Then when he grows up, he need not go and attend any PRO classes because he is a PRO in himself. The third, courage. Teach your child to become courageous. How do we teach our child to become courageous? The examples are given in the Quran. How does a child become courageous? By speaking truth. There is no courage bigger than speaking truth. It is very difficult to speak truth. So the Quran gives, Quran is also workbook like. You know, Allah gives us some exercise to do. So he says, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ. Say he is Allah one and only. Say to whom? To each other? No. To say to the people who believe in multiple gods, who are atheists. So when the child goes, encourage him to do dawah. When the child goes and speaks about one God, he gets courageous because he receives different types of responses from people. So he is becoming courageous. He is becoming stronger, courageous and braver. Then how do you teach your child to become courageous if you are weak, if you don't speak truth? We speak lies on telephones, we give false promises, we break it, and then we expect our child to learn from us. He is learning those things from us. Very dangerous. He is learning those things from us. So we ourselves have to become truthful and trustworthy. This is a quality of a believer. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, a believer can be anything, but he cannot become a liar. He cannot be a liar. So lies these days In our lives, it is very common as we breathe. Many people, we speak lies, and we are contributing a lot in spoiling our children by speaking lies and having these bad habits among us. What else can be done on a mass level? This was on individual level. On a mass level, if there are NGOs, non-government organizations, you must support them and be a part of them. It is not haram to be a part of non-government organization if they do good, because the Quran says that help each another in birr and taqwa. Help each other in birr and taqwa. And there was a time in the before the prophethood, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrates this in Medina. He says that when I was in Makkah before the prophethood, there were some people of Makkah during the pagan age. These people, they gathered and they formed a group and organization to fight against the harassment and injustice done to the weak and the poor. So they invited me and I became a member in that. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, by Allah, if somebody forms an organization today, I would join them. So joining a non-government organization is not haram. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that mix with the people as long as it does not corrupt your faith. If it does not corrupt your faith, alhamdulillah, you can mix up with the people and support them. It can give multiple signs to the world that the Muslims are ahead in social activities, in the concern about humanity. So if there are any NGOs, you can be a part. Then write letters to editors in tomorrow's workshop. Those who are participating in tomorrow's workshop, I have a special section of that. Everyday Dawah is the workshop that I'm going to conduct tomorrow in the same auditorium from 10 to 6. There I'll tell you how to become a writer also. Everybody has the potential, because in schools we had been doing writing and all. Write letters to editors, protest against whatever is going wrong in a very civilized manner, a very civilized manner. So this is what we can do. Promote Islamic way of life in our lives. Show our children the best example. Join with the people who are doing good job and fighting against evil. Join them and you can contribute a lot in the betterment of the society. With this nasiha and advice, I end my talk. And now the floor is open for you. If you want me to throw some more light on the things that I spoke, or if you have an argument, I allow you to take up the mic and speak, provided you cut short and don't elongate it. There are other brothers and sisters over here, they also want it. So, is the mic ready? Yes. Before I allow you the question, I will pose a question to you. That the thing that I spoke today, do you agree with the consequence that the parents are more responsible for the spoiling of children? How many of you agree with this? The fathers are not agreeing. Maybe they are not your fathers. Yeah, people agree with it. It is correct. Now the floor is open and raise up your hand, wait for the mic to come and he will explain the rules.
My question is, today it is the information age. Okay, every child has to be a competitive person. He has to enhance the knowledge. That is, knowledge you use it for the different purpose. That is up to the child how he frame that. Now, with this kind of situation, how our child has to get the information and enhance themselves to face with the better knowledge and able to compete. I'm not talking about compete in terms of physical or that kind of, no. I'm talking in terms of the knowledge. Because knowledge sources, the internet, the computers, and what are the information you get on the TV. That's how do we praise them and filter it and give it to the child. That's my concern.
The brother would like to know that since I showed so many frightening things about the television and other things, so what about the knowledge? One thing we must understand, that it is not necessary that the knowledge that we get from the television news is always correct knowledge. There are two types of knowledge that we get from the media. One which we want, which is very less, and the other what they want to take you as a news. So what we get is an information which becomes a part of knowledge, because people have the wrong knowledge that Islam is a religion of terrorism. It is not an information, because things has not happened like that. So it is a knowledge now. So people believe it. So knowledge becomes information and information becomes knowledge. They are both correlated. We may term it different, but it is a piece of some news which you take it as a knowledge or you take it as an information. So what should be done? See, one thing is that what it is surely dangerous to have a television, especially cable TV at home. Nobody can say that I will keep a watch on my television. In France, in the beginning, when television was launched, in the beginning, so they said that we will only show educational programs. And verbatim, they used to have classrooms on television, maths, science, workshops. But gradually, competition came on. And there were other entertainment channels. So what happened? The classroom became empty. Nobody watched that. So what? There are some people who say we watch Discovery Channel, History Channel. Then I ask them that how many hours of Discovery Channel you watch every day? Can you watch 24 hours? No, 1 hour, 2 hours. What about the rest of the time? So the Quran guides us about alcohol. It says in the beginning, it says in it is more harm and less benefit. And later on, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declared it to be haram. So in anything which has more harm and less benefit, so keep the benefit away in order to avoid the harm. So keep away from cable TV. Now where to get the knowledge from? The knowledge can be achieved from newspapers, provided you tore off all that Bangalore Times and all that. You understand, na? All those film news and third pages and all. I'm not talking about that newspaper. That is a souvenir. That is souvenir. It is not a newspaper. So I'm talking about news. Or internet. On internet, if the child watches any pornographic thing, it has been fixed on cookies. So it is very easy for the parents to catch. At least you have a watch on your child. But it should be under observation that what your child is watching. You should not give him privacy. Then he goes on chat and boyfriends and girlfriends and net affairs, cyber affairs. You understand, na? So, information is not haram in Islam. Information should be there. But what you get the information and the sources of information is also very important. So, sources of information are based on falsehood, then it is not information. It is a misinformation which can corrupt your child. So instead of letting your child get corrupt, better have him lesser informed or slower informed. Tomorrow he goes to the college and somebody tells him that, you know, train accident has taken place and 500 people have died. There was a guy, one of the person from the audience, he was arguing with me. I had a talk in one of the institution on the same subject, harmful effects of television programs, a complete talk. So that this boy, he got up and said, you know, what about entertainment? I will not say entertainment. What about news? I would like to know what's happening to my brothers in Bosnia and Palestine. I would like to know. So how can you say I should not watch it? So I said, do you know how many videos are there in your neighborhood? He said, no. Then you don't know about your neighborhood. What are you going to do about Palestine and this and that? So what responsibility Allah has given us? Allah will question us what was within our capacity. On television, what happens when we see news, we get addicted. Then this program, then that program, and this channel. So the communication between the family members goes off, switched off. You are not talking, everybody is watching. The mother is sitting, the father is sitting, everybody is watching. Suppose a good program is going on, very good program. And in comes all of a sudden, pops out an obscene advertisement. My mother is sitting, the sister is father, and everybody is sitting. Nobody is ashamed to say, change the channel also. Because if we change the channel, there will be something more weird in the next channel. So we look down and we keep on seeing. You understand? The Prophet ﷺ said, if you don't feel bad in your heart, something that is bad, there is no faith beyond that. There is no faith beyond that. So if the harm is greater, if the harm is greater than the benefit, avoid the benefit in order to avoid the harm. You can, for news, you can watch satellite channels. I'm sorry, you can watch internet, or you can get newspapers, you edit it yourself. and give it, be an editor of your own newspaper at home. You have to delete certain things. You understand? That way. Hope that answers it. Anybody else? If you have finished your snacks, you can go ahead with the questions. I'm the only person who is not eating, perhaps.
Hello, Salam.
Walaikum Salam.
My question is, I am a teacher. Now, I'm asking you that, what will my responsibility in building up a child?
Good question. The brother would like to know, I am a teacher in school?
Yes, school, in school. High school. So I am
high school means school. Teenagers.
Yeah.
11, 12, 13.
No,
11, 12, 13 years old. I was speaking about age, not classes.
Yes, sir.
So, the brother would like to know what are his duties as a teacher, what role can he play. Since I said the parents don't have time, and many of the parents may not be even present over here, so they may not be knowing also the dangers for being a lack of communicative with their children. So, you have a good role and opportunity for yourself. And what is that opportunity? That the teacher has to play the role of a mother. Besides teaching history, geography, maths, you should also cultivate manners in the child. In my time, or in the early periods of between the 70s and the 80s, the teacher was also a counselor. In spite of having 50, 60 children in the class, the teacher was very particular to know about the habits of children. That boy, he bites his nails. That boy, he does not have a good handwriting. That boy does not put oil in his head. She used to be observant. Today they have become professional. I don't know, I'm sorry if there are any teachers over here. But because of professionalism, people are focusing more on result-oriented. Like, you know, there was some news, I don't know if it appeared in the Bangalore in Maharashtra. The government is trying to implement the rule that the salary of the teacher is going to be decided by the performance of the student. Means if there are 40 out of 50 students getting first class, so the teacher gets more salary. I say instead of that, you keep the salary same, give bonus for the children good behavior. So the teachers, because their salary is based upon how good maths and English they teach, they don't care a damn about the morals of that. She's constantly worried about the family. She's a working woman. She may have some problem at home and the sir is there. So he wants more tuition because the salary is not enough. So they focus on education. So moral observation goes away. That could have been better. So what happens? That this children, this teacher has an opportunity. These teachers who are in the class, they can be the counselors. They notice some child is introvert or shy, or you know, having some problems at home, she can call him, offer him some samosas, like how Brother Umar is offering you, and talk to him on a personal level. Speak to him, ask him what his problem, win his confidence, and do it on individual level. Don't ask a child in front of the class, oh, father and mother are fighting every day, or what? So the child get embarrassed, you know. You will cause more harm. If you do counseling wrong, you will cause more harm than benefit. So, you can learn counseling, do counseling, and take a personal interest in children. And at times you can even give good advice to children. Hope that answers it.
Then we have the next question from the sisters.
If the sisters have questions, they can pose it.
Please send across the mic.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam. The sister has a prime question about the children. Sometimes the questions are embarrassing questions for the parents. Sometimes there are silly questions. Sometimes there are funny questions. And there are sometimes the questions which may be correct, but the parents may get embarrassed or the parents may get angry or irritated. You cannot say that every time the question is posed is a wrong question or an irritating question. Could be that you may find that question to be irritating, but the child requires the knowledge, especially about sex education. People debate, you know, why Muslims are objecting against sex education. So I tell them, we don't object against sex education. We object about the syllabus of sex education. and the methodology of sex education. In the name of sex education, if you teach girls how to avoid pregnancy, you are not teaching sex education, you are teaching them fornication. Because you are teaching them how to avoid pregnancy. So it is the duty of the mother to teach the daughter about things regarding menstruation and other hygiene. And it is the duty of the father, not the friends of his son. It is the duty of the father to teach his son about the hygiene things, things related to hygiene. Then at times, if there can be funny questions, amusing questions, you may not like it. So instead of scolding the child or giving a wrong answer, try to speak to him that this question is irrelevant. If he goes to his friend and comes back and tells you that my friend tells this, so at that time, if you find that the answer given by his friend is wrong, you have an opportunity to discuss with your child at that time. You discuss with your child at that time. No, your friend, for example, the child says, Mama, is smoking allowed? Is it good? So he said, but I don't ask this type of question, it is bad. But my friend says, you know, it is stylish. Hero smokes, cricketers smoke, that uncle, he drives a car, imported car, he also smokes. Are these people fool? So that question is not a silly question. It's an intelligent question. And the answer is required. You cannot avoid. So you have to tell him, beta, he is not driving a car because he is smoking. He has not become a cricketer because he smokes. Smoking has nothing to do with playing cricketer. But in fact, his career will be ended, or he become old faster because he smokes and plays cricket. You understand? These are the smart replies that you have to give to the child and argue with them. Learning arguments is the best thing. Because the child is an inquisitive mind. You know inquisitive mind? He sees this mic and he asks you, how does the voice goes inside and comes out from that box? So it's not a foolish question. It's a question. So because you are not a scientific and you don't know the science of this, that does not mean that you give a wrong answer. You can give an ordinary answer, like, you know, this is the magnetic, something that attracts, and there is a system over there. Next time that uncle comes, I will ask him to teach him. So instead of avoiding, talk to your child and speak to him and give him further notification that from where he can get more knowledge. Hope that answers your sister. Should the parents
observe equality and spending on the children gives anything?
It's a good question. That are parents supposed to be equal in spending money on children? Like there should be equality in spending money on children? If not, will Allah answer? Will they have to answer Allah? See, there are two types of equality. One is the quality equality and the other is quantity equality. For example, if I have two sons, one of them is fat and tall and the other is thin and short. So when I take my thin son out for a shopping and buy 2 meters of clothes for his shirt, that does not mean that my fat son should also be given 2 meters only, because he requires 3 meters. You understand? So here the equality will be, I will give him more. That is the equality. Equality of quality. You understood? Very simple. The equality here is, he has to be given more he deserves. My thin son eats only one chapati. I cannot stop my healthy son to say, no, you cannot eat 2 chapatis. Allah will catch me. Allah will not catch you for that. You understand? Equality means equality in love, affection, attention. You send one child in a very good school and the other child in a municipality school. That is not equality. That is wrong. You favor one child and give him a Hero Honda and the other child does not even have bus money. It is not like that. That equality is not allowed. That's why, you know, there are scholars who say that if a parent, if fathers, if they give a property to son when they are alive, they have to give equal amount of property to the daughters. After the death, inheritance becomes half. But when he is alive, he has to give equal amount to both the son and the daughter. So for the parents, it is necessary that they fulfill the requirement of the child while doing justice and equality. If they don't know how should be done in this matter, they can inquire from a person who is knowledgeable in fiqh and sharia, Islamic jurisprudence, or a maulana. Then maulana, I want to distribute the wealth, can you help me? They will help you. They won't take any commissions. They will help you. But when I said about equality in spending time, yes, you take one child to McDonald's and the other child you offer him vada pav and idli, that is also not equality. So equality in terms of quality, quantity has to be considered, and you have to see, depends upon individual cases also at times. For example, your child has to go somewhere out of Bombay and the time is very less, so you have to arrange for a flight for him. That does not mean that you have to keep a separate amount for the other son. It is not like that. It was as per his requirement, that example of two chapati and one chapati. But both of them want to go to Bombay and you send one child by air, the other by train, purposely because you know you find the child is more, he's obedient to me, this and that. So because of that you do, it is injustice. There are parents at times, they do injustice to children because one of the child is in obedience. And he says, my child does not obey me. So I say, if your child does not obey you, yet you have to obey Allah Almighty. There was a gentleman who came yesterday from Hyderabad to IRF. He told me that, Padani sir, you know, my father has driven me out of his wealth. I said, no, he cannot do that. He says that I am disobedient. I said, you may be disobedient, son, but he has to be obedient to Allah Almighty. What Allah has commanded him, he has to give. That's all. Hope that answers it.
Assalamualaikum.
Walaikum salam.
I have two questions.
Yes.
One of them is, like, is it justified to hit children as punishment? And secondly, I want to ask, like, young children only about say 3 years or 4 years ask about how kids are born, how children are born, and such questions which we cannot, you know, elaborate and answer. How can we avoid these kind of questions, and how can we pacify them?
It's a good question. There are two questions. First, is it allowed to hit children? And second, questions posed by young children which can be embarrassing for parents. So I'll answer the first question first and the second question. Hitting children is not prohibited in Islam. Neither it is highly encouraged, nor it is farz, unless in some condition. For example, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if your child does not pray when he reaches 10 or 11, when he reaches the age of puberty, you hit him. Now this hitting does not mean that pick up a stick and the poor fellow is sleeping and you start hitting him, whacking him. Some parents, they take this as a liberty or a license to hit children very rudely, very cruelly, which is un-Islamic. It makes the children rigid, and one day they become rebel. Then they shout at their mothers when they grow up 16, 17 years and the parents have grown old. So they shout back. They have become rebellious. Deed bana diya. You know, in Urdu they say deed bana diya. So when Islam permits the beating of a child, it also forbids the people to be rude towards the children. Because there was a man who came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he saw Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam being kind and compassionate towards Hasan Hussein radhiyallahu ta'ala. So the man said, oh Rasulullah, you show so much love to children, we don't show. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if Allah has not put love in your heart, what can I do? That means if you love a child, it is love put by Allah Almighty in your heart. It's a blessing. But yet that does not give the liberty to the child to do whatever he wants to go against the Sharia. So it depends upon the individual case. You cannot say general yes or general no, that it is permitted always and it is not permitted always. You cannot say general yes or general no. What you have to do? You have to look into the case as why the child requires beating. But before beating him, did I ask him, like for example, my son is sleeping and I hit him with a stick, get up for the Fajr prayer, is it all right? No. Did I try, come on Maruf, get up, it's the time for Fajr prayers. Did I woke him up? No. Directly hitting is also wrong thing. So at least you put your efforts, you wake him up, you talk to him, come on Maruf beta, come on get up. Then finally you see that the time is reaching out and it's time for qaza. At that time you can hit him, then why are you not praying? Even when he uses foul languages, you talk to him, you warn him, and then you can beat him. But the beating should not be rude and cruel. Hope that answers it. Now question number two.
Assalamu
about children posing embarrassing question which cannot be answered, and if they answer they don't even understand. So what should be done? It is better to avoid questions to very young children, 3 years, 4 years. Or you can use a truth in a modified manner. Like you can say, you know, Allah sends a child. Allah bhejta hai. Allah sends a child. So she will have her own perception. And that perception will remain in her mind or the child's mind for some time when she is grown up. And then she can be told or he can be told. So initially, when you said Allah ne bheja, Allah has sent the child. So it is not a lie that you are speaking. And neither the answer is embarrassing. The answer is quite correct, 100% correct. But what you wanted to avoid, you avoided it. So it depends upon how you frame your answer and put it to your child. Hope that answers it. Can you repeat the problem? What is the problem over here? What is the problem?
No, they are not able to, their parents are not able to bring up their children as expected, either by religion or by the society.
Yes, now it's so complete. The question is that what about those poor children, specified poor people, lower middle class,
below
poverty line?
Especially my observation, I have seen, I have been visiting also in the slum area. It is not only the non-Muslims are living there. Majority of Muslims are living in the slum area, and their behavioral pattern and their parents' living condition, they are not able to give any attention to their children. Is it not our responsibility as a society, as a religion also?
It's a good question. That isn't it the society? The brother would like me to give the message or a reminder to the audience over here, that what is our responsibility towards those poor section of our community whose children are being brought up among crime, violence, because we know these things happen over there. It happens everywhere in the society, even in rich society also. It happens in five-star hotels also. But we are focusing on children below poverty line. And as I said in one of the Quranic verses, that you are brought out for the benefit of mankind, Surah Imran chapter 3 verse 110. So in the same line it helps that you should, as I said, that we must form an NGO. If there are any NGOs which are working among those poor people, we must join them. There is no harm in joining them. And go, because these NGOs, they are registered and they work in a form of a group. So when they work in a group, the strength is more. It is a strong, you know, one person working on individual capacity and a person in group working, there is a difference. So we have a system of Jamaat also. We go for prayer 5 times a day in the masjid. Why? Because the group is always has its impact. When we come out 50, 60 people of the masjid, it's a group. So in the form of a team, it should be done. How? There are two ways. First, on individual capacity, like take your family members to slums and talk to them. Or tell your maid who stays, the woman, poor woman who comes to your house and works as a washerwoman or washing the utensils of your house. You tell her that bring your relatives over here one day, I want to talk to them. There is nothing harm in offering food and tea and biscuits to poor people. It's not that he's a servant so he cannot be fed, or we should feed him the biryani only the next day from what is left over. That is not the way. So on an individual capacity, you have to do it. On a collective level, the best is the role of the masjid. The role of the masjid. Because it is not possible to reach out everybody. reach out every home. Suppose there are 100 homes in a slum. How much time it requires to go and tell everybody? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us a facility in the masjid, especially on Juma. So in Juma, you have 100 people at a time. Now you have 45 minutes of khutbah, the Juma Friday. In this 45 minutes, you can speak to the people what you want to speak about hygiene and keeping those clean, because it is not haram in Islam. So those of you who are trustees of masjid, or those of you who know imams as your friends, who pray in a masjid, who lead the prayers in the masjid in a slum area, so you can go and talk to them, say, Maulana, why don't you speak on cleanliness? Why don't you speak this time on Juma prayers? So this Maulana will also get motivated and you get the reward. As Surah Nisa chapter 4 verse 86 says, that whoever intercedes for a good cause shall have a share in it. So interceding for a good cause, telling a Maulana that, Maulana, can you give some khutbah on this? You can even help him in finding out the hadith if you are well versed in Quran and Sunnah, and ask him, he can deliver the message. Second, during the month of Ramzan, when we go to distribute the charity, or when we distribute the meat of the sacrificial animal, when we go there, we have a chance of meeting the people, spot out who is the leader or who is the group leader among their slum. You can talk to them, you can invite him to your office and talk to him that these are the things that are happening in the slums. Why don't you keep your slums nice, clean? See, Islam is nothing but good advice. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has repeated many advice again and again in Quran. The story of Musa, not less than 12 times. Because reminder, reminder, reminder. So by just telling once, it is not enough. You have to put a continuous effort for these people. Talk to them, invite them, find out if their children, they require books or uniform in the month of June when the school starts. These people, they don't have enough of money. So here is your time to build a goodwill that this man, what he tells is good. Why? Because he's been doing good to my children. So you provide him a tiffin box or a raincoat or an umbrella or new shoes or bag, school bag, or buy textbooks for him, pay his fees. Find out such families, sponsor them in groups. So what will happen next time when you go to them, they will collect around you and you can talk to them. How was your exams? Nice. You pass? Oh, yes sir. You got new uniform? Very good. But then why is this place very dirty near the locality? So now you are interacting with them. You are teaching them responsibilities. Why? Because your obligations are upon him. So once they are under your obligation, they have a chance. Their heart is open to listen to what you say. So it is a two-way. One, you have to put efforts yourself, spend money, and second, you be nice to them. Both the things work together, and inshallah the results will be seen. Hope that answers it. You want to add some more comments on that, brother? Would you like to add some more comments on that from what I said?
Thank you for the comments. I fully agree with your viewpoints, but in my experience, I have different opinion. Because I have observed in the morning, any group of people after the morning namaz, they go around the houses. The houses, people who are well to do, but they don't venture to go to such places where you have just now suggested. I suggested them. Then they just quit from my place, because they don't want to face that. They think that I am a bit hostile to them. But what I feel is I think we agree that it is the responsibility of our religion to see that.
Yes. There is no need for me to think. It is written. It is my duty. I have no need to think about it. Samay na vatana, heard and obeyed.
I said we agree.
Yeah, we agree. Even if we don't obey, we have to agree that this is true. A person may not pray five times, but he has to agree that it is false.
Also, after hearing you, also what I feel, what message you have given to this audience, more than this, this should be given to the Maulanas, the mosque and madrasas.
Yes, that suggestion I have given to my brothers over here, that if you know Maulanas, if you know the trustees of the Maulanas, you can go. And brother, as long as they don't do it, I suggest you, along with your friends, you take initiative. When people see you, you go to the slums, you talk to the people, you start. Don't wait for somebody else to do it. Ahmad Didat did not wait for somebody else to start. He started doing it. Today people make him as an icon of Dawah. Dr. Zakir Naik did not wait somebody to start and I'll join. Let us start, you start. Perchance, There may be thousands of people joining you later on, and you get the reward, sawab e jariya, from what they do. Hope that answers it. The sister had a question over there, at the back.
I have a question on the screen. I think in relation to that. The question is adoption allowed in Islam? If yes, how are we supposed to treat an adopted child and own child? Can we treat them equally?
The brother would like to know that, is adoption allowed in Islam, and do we have to treat the adopted son as their own son? So now there are different angles to these answers, and I'll try to answer as much as I know. Adoption is not allowed in Islam. What type of adoption? To get a child and give your paternal name to him. Like somebody's child, I say, he's my son. Like other adoption, other communities do. This is not allowed in Islam. It is mentioned very clearly in Surah Azab that adoption is not allowed. But guardianship is allowed, especially of the orphans. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the person who looks after an orphan, brings up an orphan, will be like this in paradise with me. Look at the status of the person who brings up an orphan. Today, unfortunately, in our community, we are not willing to get along with our brother's children. Forget my adopting somebody's orphan. If there's a joint family, my brother is staying, my wife cannot tolerate his children, my brother's children. So there is a continuous fight. Let us take a separate house. How can we have that man mind set up of having orphans? Which is wrong. Because in the time of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, there were no orphanages. There is no concept of orphanages in Muslims. We started imitating the other community. The orphans should be brought up in our own house. Why not? How much expense does an orphan require? And we believe in destiny. We believe that every child, he gets his own destiny written. He will not share from my taqdeer at all. He is going to get, if I have an orphan in my family, if I bring an orphan, Allah is not going to subtract any wealth from my destiny or my children and give it to him. Allah will provide me more so that I can feed him and I can dress him. That is called believing in qadr. We have to believe in destiny. But now what happens? That when these children are brought up in a house, many of these children have been treated as servants. Like if I have an orphan in my house, my son will go to St. Blaise's or St. Xavier's or Don Bosco, and this child will be put in a municipality school. So in the morning, he has to get up early and wipe the house and clean the house and pack up my son's bag, and he will go and leave my son to school carrying his bag, and my son goes like a nawab. And the poor fellow. So this is not sawab. This is going to be, you know, a cause of punishment. This is an indirect slavery. If I find somebody, I tell them, this is indirect slavery you have started. You have restarted the slavery, concept of slavery. Because this is not the way orphans have to be brought up. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, even if you have a slave in your house, even if you have a slave in your house, feed him what you eat and dress him what you wear. If you wear a raiment coat, you get a raiment coat for him. This is for slaves. So what about an orphan whose guardianship we have taken? Of course, he has to be brought up along with the children. Feed him what we eat and dress him what my son wears. Send him to the same school. He is not going to share anything from your destiny. He will get what is written in his destiny. But Islam protects the guardians. How? The child who is being brought up as an orphan under my guardianship, he will not have a share in my property. That Allah has kept for my children. So this is the advantage. So I have an orphan daughter. I bring up that daughter. And when she grows up, I get her married to somebody else. Now she is happy. She went to school. She became a graduate. Now she is married with her husband. My children's property is safe with me. So while exhorting or while encouraging Muslims to take up the guardianship of orphans and other poor children who don't have, whose parents don't have wealth and they have many children, while Islam encourages them, while encouraging guardianship of orphans, Islam also protects the interest of the parents and his children. That this child will not take your share, don't worry. He will be fed with you, that Allah will reward you, Allah will bless you. But when he grows up, he has no share in your property. So Islam encourages guardianship rather than sending the children in orphanages. Hope that answers it. We can have that. There was a question from that side. There is a comment and there is a question that how to protect our children from being sexually exploited or being victim of sexual abuse, especially in the neighborhood, neighbors and chaukidars and gurkha, the children are young, they don't know. So how to protect them and how to find out? See, the thing is that you cannot find out because unseen is known only to Allah Almighty. But you can discuss with your child that this is bad. If so, has somebody done to you, the child may say that yes, he has done to me. Confident. The child many a time is afraid of telling the parents, though he wishes to tell. Because of parents' strict nature, they will shout at me, they will scold at me, something will happen. Because parents, that's why people who are short-tempered, especially in the presence of children, their children, they don't open their hearts with them. Because right from the childhood, they are afraid of the parents. They are afraid of anger. So, parents, apparently they should be polite and courteous with the children even when they are angry. When you are angry, there is a style of anger. Anger should not be like a volcano. That, oh, because you know, my child did something wrong, so you blow away your temper like a volcano and you shout like your child, poor fellow. He may correct himself, but the damage that has been done to his psychology is very severe. So, the child is not opening up to his parents. That's why I say the parents are confident. They take the child into confidence and ask him. This is the one way. Second is to make your child programmed that you are having confidence in him and he should have confidence in you. If anything unruly takes place in his life, you should be the first person to be informed. It should be a part of your life. So in this way you can prevent. And if you find somebody else's child has been sexually abused in your neighborhood, so you should support that family in taking legal actions. Help each other in birr and taqwa. It may not be your child, somebody else's child. But if the culprit is free, tomorrow it can be in your house also. So when that family is taking action, don't leave him alone. Be with him, support him. Help him find an advocate, accompany him to the police station, find out some government organization, non-government organizations and government offices, social offices and police offices, find out, help them. So once you are with them, they are morally strong. So next time, God forbid it, anything happens to you, there are people who will be supporting you. So helping each other and birr and taqwa, commanding that which is good and stopping that which is evil is the role and responsibility of a Muslim. So this is how you can control it. Then your comment about having a school in Bangalore. We already have a school in Chennai, you must be knowing that. But it is not run by IRF. It is under our supervision. The people of that locality, they gathered, they bought a plot and they started the school and they took a franchise. So we send Qaris and Hafiz from our school. We supervise them once a year. Zakir Naik visit, he doesn't go there. The syllabus is ready, we provide them the syllabus. That's all. So if you want to start a school in Bangalore, which is not a bad idea, indeed it is a highly recommended idea, very good idea, but you have to give your time and your wealth for that. You have to approach some rich and influential people over here and request him that how about having a small property and start a school from lower level, third standard, fourth standard, and Allah will keep on helping you and then the school will grow. So we are open for franchise, for counseling. If anybody wants to start school, they can come to us at the IRF, contact Brother Makbul and speak to him. He will guide you how you can go ahead. But don't expect IRF everywhere. We cannot have an IRF center in Bangalore. We cannot have school in Bangalore. Because we, when we run the school, we supervise it ourselves. And it is not possible for us to come and run the school over here. So what we do? We interview the teachers who would be teaching your children. We interview the parents whose children will be studying with your children. And then we give you legal consultation. We provide you the syllabus. These are the things that we can give. More, you have to work because it is your community over here. It is your duty. So you have to work on that. Rather than expecting Zakir Naik everywhere, there is only one Zakir Naik. So we have to produce more Zakir Naiks in Bangalore. Children, these children will grow up and they start their own schools. So you can approach us if anybody was form a small group and start a school. Hope that answers it. We have time for a couple of questions more. Yes.
Assalamu alaikum. Walaikum salam. My name is Atil. I'm a businessman. Ask me a question. This is a common question. If you concern about neighborhood, how should a Muslim live with non-Muslim neighbors? In this case, like, there are so many things that are permissible for the non-Muslims and not permissible for the Muslims. And if the family head has some constraints of changing the neighborhood, what is the authority he has?
What is the?
Other authority he has to do.
The brother would like to know that what about neighborhood and what about Muslims in non-Muslim neighborhood and how to reduce this influence, because there are different types of neighborhoods. See, the answer cannot be perfectly yes or blanket no. Islam does not forbid you to stay in a neighborhood where there are people of other communities. The Sahaba, they left their Gulf and they came to India, they went to China and they were in complete minority and yet they spread Islam. So neighborhood does influence your life, your children's life, but as you, as a responsible Muslim, you should also try to influence the neighborhood. That is our duty. We should influence the neighbor. One Muslim in the neighborhood means if there is a breakage in the water pipe, he will be the first one to go and complain to the municipality. That should be the image. He should be the first one to complain any unseen or indecent incident taking place. He should be, means a Muslim in a society should be a blessing for the society. Not that his children should be the most mischievous and, you know, having affairs with Hindu girls and Christian girls. That is a bad Muslim. So the Muslim should be such that next time a person wants to sell his flat, he will say, you know, my flat is expensive. Why? Because my neighbor is a Muslim. Means you are protected. That is how a Muslim should be. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has narrated it. There are many hadiths which tells us about the virtues of neighbor and being a good neighbor. How important it is to become good neighbor. One should even tolerate bad neighbors at times. You have to tolerate them at times when you receive a lot of harassment from them. But that does not mean that neighborhood can be totally neglected. If you find a hostile neighborhood, like you are staying in a place where people are hostile towards your religion, in that case, it is highly recommended that you do hijrat and go to a place where you are safe, especially in the Muslim locality. It is also good if you stay in a neighborhood where there is a masjid, because there is an Islamic environment. If you stay in a totally non-Muslim environment where there are no Muslims, you will be away from your culture. It is not, it is haram. I am showing you the dangers which can be. Your child will go to 31st night and dance, which is again wrong. He'll celebrate Christmas, because in a Muslim neighborhood, you could not train your child to be a dai over there. If he is a dai, he can go and influence the neighborhood. Otherwise, he can be influenced by neighbors. So in that case, it is better to have Islam in your, it is compulsory to have Islamic environment in your house and try to promote Islam in the neighborhood also by being nice to your neighbors, visiting them when they are sick, providing them monetary help if they require. So in this way, you can promote Islamic values in the neighborhood. And then if there are few non-Muslims, they will be also influenced by Islam. So you cannot say blanket yes, that you have to stay only in the Muslim area. Nor you can say blanket no, that you are not allowed to stay in a non-Muslim area. Hope that answers it. The brother had a question. We'll have the last question from the sister's side after this. For more questions, inshallah, some other time when I come.
Assalamu alaikum.
Walaikum salam.
My name is Abdul Nadir. I have a question.
children studying non-Muslim schools, especially the schools run by Christians and Hindus. And the children spend about 6 to 7 hours there, and they are badly affected by the non-Islamic environment and the programs and functions run in those schools. So what is the solution for this?
The brother has a question which requires a big talk on the subject. Alhamdulillah, it is a very important thing that you consider the importance or the consider seriousness of a children studying in a non-Muslim school, especially in a Christian-run school or a Hindu-run school, and there are some un-Islamic activities happening over there. The best thing is to put your child in an Islamic school. If it is not there, then when you put your child in a non-Islamic school, see that your child, before he goes to school or while he is in the school, you program him to influence his friends. If your child is strong in faith and has an Islamic environment at home, he will be influencing the other children. For example, if you see modern contemporary scholars, Dr. Zakir Naik, Jamal Badvi, Dr. Bilal Phillips, they are all from non-Muslim schools. Non-Muslim schools. But because the environment that they got and the spirit that they had, they grew into converting people, inviting people to Islam and rewarding people to Islam in thousands. So a Christian school or a Hindu school will not influence your child as long as you are not careless. As long as you are careless. If you are careless towards your child, if you don't have a time to communicate with your child, if there is no Islam in your house, then there is a danger of your child being corrupted. So have an Islamic environment at your place. Have an Islamic environment at your place and make your child a da'i, courageous person, that he can talk about Islam to people. And then keep a watch. If there are any activities that are taking place in the school which are un-Islamic, you can go with the parents of other Muslims as well as non-Muslims and approach the authorities. For example, in our schools of Bombay, there's a Christian school and they were not allowing the girls to wear shalwar, grown-up girls to wear shalwar and dupatta. So one person used to go here and there, so the teacher, the principal said, you know, if you don't want your child now, if you, we are not going to change the rules of the school. You want, you can keep your child. Otherwise, go and change the school. Because he was one. Later on, he collected 20, 30, 50 parents. And then they went and said, sir, if you don't allow a child, children and daughters to wear shalwar, there is a new school being built up over here. We will be going there. And we have also received permission from them that they would allow our daughters to wear shalwar kameezes in schools. But because our children have studied in this school, so we prefer continuing in this school, but this is a condition. And when he saw 50 students, so he realized 50 students leaving the school at a time, it can cause a bad name to the school. It can cause a bad name to him also. That what kind of a principal? The trustees would fire him. So the next term, the school permitted to wear the girls to wear shalwar and dupatta. So this is how you apply pressure. Applying pressure is a tactic. Instead of being hostile and violent and shouting and regretting and trying only single-handedly, build a team. This is how you raise your voice. Build a team and find out among the team who is influential, who is an advocate, who is a doctor, and make them spokesman and let them go and talk and you be a part of the team. So somebody else will do the job and you get an equal reward. So it requires time and efforts to build the team, and then you can take up the case, go to the principal, tell them this Valentine's Day is very bad for children, we don't want. Apply pressure. Even the Hindus and the Christian parents would agree with you, because nobody wants your daughters to be exploited in schools. So they will also join you, but you have to initiate. Speak up for the true cause. Hope that answers it. We can have the last question from the sister side.
Assalamu alaikum.
Walaikum salam wa rahmatullah.
I'm Salima, I'm a housewife. I see we still go the Islamic way. We find some deficiency in us putting the Islamic thoughts in our children. For example, I don't agree with the birthday parties with children nowadays, but we see us own Muslim brothers and sisters, they held up extravagant birthday parties. and they expect all the Muslim children also to participate. So when I go, I go against the thought, I try to explain my child, see, this is haram and we should not enroll in it. So ultimately the child understands, but at the same time they feel sad, see, we don't get birthday gifts, all the children are getting birthday gifts. But I make it a point that in Eid we exchange gifts, but still our children, you know, they feel, you know, they say that it is so boring, we don't have any celebrations, that alhamdulillah, only in my family we don't have any celebrations, as in Bangalore you have so many customs and rituals which are celebrated over here. So they try comparing with the other families, you know, they say it is so boring, we don't have any celebrations at our home except in Eid. So how do we explain our children that Islam has no celebrations other than Eid?
Sister would like to know, how should you explain the celebrations to a child, and this is haram, and certain things may deviate, but because everybody, even there are many Muslim families who celebrate the children's birthday and they invite our children, so at times our children may agree and at times they get frustrated when they come to know the next day the party was grand and there were gifts and cakes and everything. So what to do in this situation? See sister, it is correct that because of haram things involved, birthday party is haram. And according to Bible, it was Firaun who started celebrating birthdays. But how to explain a child? When the child is when you forbid your child from going to a birthday party, he wants something in compensation. That's why he said it is boring. So you take him somewhere, to a garden, to McDonald's, to a nice hotel, and you feed him nicely. Or you tell him, we'll make some pani puris and bhel puris at home today. You invite your friends tomorrow. Why wait for birthday, my son? Invite tomorrow. Let's have a party. Let's have a get-together. So feast is not haram in Islam. Inviting people for food is not haram in Islam. It's not at all haram in Islam. Now what will happen? That when your children's friends, when they come to your house for a dinner or a lunch on Sundays, so you talk to them, beta, you know why my son does not celebrate birthday? Because there is extravagance. You may have a grown-up daughter, a sister, and somebody from the friend circle may look at your sister. You show him, and you brainwash the child. So the next year, the child will tell his parents, no, I don't want birthday parties. I don't want birthday parties. Instead of explaining only to your child, why don't you work upon your child's friends also? You tell them, my son. Invite them and tell them, see, I'm celebrating a feast. Here there is a hijab system, my daughter is inside, you are my son's friends, so you can have nice food over here and play some Islamic songs. Now there are non-musical Islamic naats and other good songs, Arabic songs are also available. You can play, you can have a quiz competition. Come on now, I'll ask quiz, not only from Islamic, you can have general quiz also. So the children will enjoy, give some small gift, and of a small pen, ball pens, or a small diary, anything, gifts. The children love gifts. So you get, correct answer, take this gift. So in this way, the children will enjoy. So what will happen? The children will put pressure upon their parents. You know, why don't you invite my friends without birthday? So you are helping in a sunnah being revived. Sunnah of giving gifts, sunnah of inviting people for food and hospitality, and sunnah of correcting your Muslim brothers. So three things in one activity. Hope that answers it. Jazakallah wa khairan for the nice gathering over here. Alhamdulillah, it was a very good experience for me. And I have given this talk, Who Spoils the Children, multiple times in colleges and elsewhere. I've been invited, even in Hindu circles also, they invited me to give a talk on that. This was a very important topic. And I came here all the way to, because Bangalore and Pune are my favorite outstation where I go and have a very friendly audience, and this is one of it. So once again, Jazakallah khairan for being with me over here. Tomorrow also there will be a program which the brother would announce. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.
خير الخلق كلهم. الكونين والثقلين والفريقين من عرب ومن عجم. أوذيت في الله لم تهزم ولم تهيني حتى غادت أمة الإسلام في النجوم.